All right, and how are you guys? My name is Saurabh Mutha, and I'm the Yashas team at An Academy. Today's session is a very, very interesting session. It covers for CA Inter students the RTP of November 21. Guys, RTP is really important, and during our preparation, we often forget to do RTPs, MTPs, etc. And hence, I'm giving to you the RTP of November 21. We'll solve every question, including the MCQs. I'll help you how to present it in the exam, and we will cover everything. This is CA Inter DT, the income tax bit, November 21 RTP. But before that, let me tell you a little about what we're doing at An Academy and for CA Inter students especially. This one is just showing something on the screen that you will find definitely very, very useful. This is a CA iconic program. This program is basically a flagship program for CA intermediate aspirants. What is this iconic and what is so iconic about it? Let me show you. There is a one-on-one live mentoring program, which is part of this iconic, where you can get 100 one-on-one personal coaching, where you get doubt solving. You'll get evaluated test series. Yes, you heard it right. Whatever they teach you, they're also going to test you, and they're going to conduct a test series. They'll give you printed books, industry expert sessions, and much more. So all that and more will be a part of this iconic program. Just telling you some things more, which are here. Just one second. Perfect. In the live one-on-one mentoring, you will get expert learning. The experts will help you clarify doubts, concepts, and anything that you want to understand from them. Plus, just one second. The evaluated test series also they're talking about here. That gives you definitely an extra edge to your preparation, and the live tests which will be conducted here to help you understand and gauge your preparation. Plus, of course, they've told you the subscriptions, and there are more benefits if you use the code YashasLife. So YashasLife is the code that you need to use. They also have a bundled offer for CA Foundation and with the CA Intermediate together. So use this code. Personally, I really, really appreciate An Academy and Yashas coming together for this initiative. And also, I feel bad that I didn't have anything when I was studying for CA exams. I didn't have any of this to help me prepare for my CA exams. Everything is online. Everything is delivered right to you on your computer or your laptop or your mobile phone screen. Perfect. And now it's today's agenda. Let me tell you today's agenda. Today's agenda is the RTP for November 21. This is for CA Inter students. And this one is the RTP for November 21. Of course, now, which is December 21, but it doesn't matter, guys. Any RTP is really good because RTPs are given by ICAI. So they tell you what ICAI is expecting out of you in this. Guys, before we go to the RTP, let me tell you, we're looking at the DT portion, which is the Income Tax Act portion. If you've done it, great. If you want to recap it, we already have a fast track course of this on An Academy. And if you're a May 22 student, by the way, and watching this, if you're a May 22 student, I also want to show you something which is very interesting, which we are bringing together. Again, the Yashas team and the An Academy team are bringing to you the accelerated program. It's a May 22 attempt for the May 22 attempt. Guys, this one is really, really important and really special. If you're looking at May 22 exam and you want to ace the exam, accelerate your preparations with a batch, which is 100% English batch for group one, this one starts on 13th October. So it'll cover all the group one subjects. These are the educators who will teach you accounting, costing, tax, law. All of the group one faculties are here. They're live interactive classes, unlimited recorded classes in case you want to look at any concepts more. There are multiple educators. You will get notes. One subscription gets you multiple benefits. And hence, use the code YASHAS to subscribe. Iconic subscription as well as a normal subscription. This I've already shared with you. And this one is something that you already know. Coming back, in case you're looking at December, so let me just break it down. In case you're looking for December 21, we already have a fast track course. You can watch my entire tax, the entire tax, there is DT as well as GST, is the fast track course is already done. You can watch it and really, really helpful. I've given you so many tricks there to help you remember shortcuts, remember concepts. And I will also show you, we've also covered exam questions there. Everything to get you great marks in the exam has been covered there. And if you're a May 22 students, then even better, we have the comprehensive course for you starting 13th of October. All right, and with that, let's start off our RTP. It's just telling you from an exam perspective, residential status is something that is really important that is tested in the RTP. then what is the scope of income? What are the different incomes which are taxable? That is tested in the RTP. Plus the heads of income, house property, plus salaries, plus PGBP, plus capital gain, plus IFOS, all these are tested in the RTP. In the RTP, they don't have a question on clubbing, but clubbing is also important from a CA into perspective. They have a big, nice question on set-off. And then, of course, there is GTI. There is no sum on GTI, but GTI is generally a calculation. From that, your minus deductions, you don't add it, but I'm just showing you that's another chapter. We are also covering deductions in RTP. And then you have total income on which you'll need to calculate the tax. All of these concepts are covered through different questions in the RTP. Of course, once you figure your tax, you also have to file your return of income. Even that has been covered in the RTP. So all this and more is going to be done in today's session on RTP. Let's continue. And let's make sure this is a great session for all of us. I'm just going to open up the RTP in front of you so that we all are on the same page. Perfect. This is the RTP. Guys, this RTP has some case study, and this is exactly how your exam will also be. They will give you a case scenario, and which will be followed by a couple of MCQs. Here you see there are different MCQs. Against each MCQ, I've given you the chapter also from which it is, so you get an idea about where is this MCQ coming from. So there are about 10 MCQs, and then there is 11th, a proper question on deductions, 12th, a set-off question, 13th, the question on computation, 14th, another computation question. Computation is very important. The first sum that you see in your paper will be a computation sum. And the last one that we will do is on a mix of return of income and other things. So this is what we're going to look at. Let's see how much we can do in the time that we have, but let's make the most of it. As and when I go ahead, I will also help you solve it. And I will also give you examination. How do you present it in the exam? That kind of understanding I will also give you. Let's start. The first one is Mr. Animish. Mr. Animish is an Indian citizen. All this is really important. Animish is an Indian citizen and he's 61 years. Basically now for his rates of tax, for his deductions, you have to consider him as a senior citizen. He has set up his business in Canada. His business is in Canada and he's residing in Canada since 2009. Guys, typically when they give you this, they're trying to tell you something and they're trying to make you assume that he's a non-resident, but don't assume. Till they give you all the details, don't assume that someone is a resident or non-resident. Calculate it. Ask them the questions. Only then conclude. He owns a house property in Canada. So he has a business in Canada, house property in Canada. Just writing Canada here. So house property in Canada, plus he has a business in Canada. Just 1 second. Plus he has a business in Canada. And house property, half of which is used as a resident, that is self-occupied, and half is given on rent, which is 12 lakh rupees per annum. But whether I want to tax him or no, that I will only come to know once I know his residential status. So let's continue reading ahead. He purchased a flat in Delhi in the year 1819. So this is India. I'm just putting India incomes here. He has a flat in Delhi, so house property in Delhi, which he purchased in the year 1819. So this year, the year in the question is, guys, 2021, financial year 2021, which is basically the financial year for your exam. The stamp duty of the value is 35 lakh, but he purchased for 42 lakh. He's paid a little more, but this is not concerning this year, so will not impact this year at all. He has taken a loan from Canara Bank of India of 34 lakhs for purchase of this flat. Of course, a lot of properties are taken on loan. He's taken this one on loan. And the interest on such loan is 3,14,000 and the principal is 80,000. The moment I see interest and principal, guys, I know deductions of interest will happen if he's given it on rent. And principal payment definitely will happen. Principal payment happens from under section 80C. I already know there are some deductions, 80C. But why do I know before residential status? Because it's India income, whether he's a resident or non-resident, he will get these deductions. Mr. Animish has given his flat on a monthly rent of 32,500 since April 2019. So guys, this is a monthly rent. During the entire year, he's given it on rent and he's taking a rent of 32,500. So this will help you calculate your GAV. Then they may have given also municipal taxes. Then 30% deduction is flat. And then there is an interest deduction already waiting for you. The annual property tax is basically the municipal tax, is 40,000, which is paid by him whenever he comes to India to meet his parents. He has visited India for 124 days during the previous year. Before that, he visited India for 366 days during the... So in India, guys, this last line, last two lines, basically talk about the residential status. He has visited India for 124 days in this year, and the last 4 years, he's visited India for 366 days. Very interesting. This question is tackling an amendment that happened in the Finance Act 2021. We'll see it when we see that amendment. He had a house in Ranchi. He had a house in Ranchi, which was sold in May 2017. In respect of this house, he received some arrears of rent, again, which is house property. So this is house property details. He also derived other income during the following: a profit from business in Canada. This is profit from business in Canada, 2,75,000, which is in Canada business. He had interest on bonds. I'm also writing interest here, which is 6,20,000, out of which 50% was received in India. So in India also, you received something. So I'm putting interest here as well. Income from apple orchard in Nepal, given on contract. So this is not Canada, this is Nepal, but I'm just putting abroad, Canada plus Nepal. Apple orchard, again, a business. Orchid, I'm just writing orchid. This was in Nepal. On contract, in the yearly contract fee of 5,00,000 was received by Animesh in Nepal. So he earned it in Nepal and he received it in Nepal as well. Moving ahead. Mr. Animesh had sold 10,000 listed shares. That means on a stock market, he sold 10,000 shares at 480 rupees of an A Limited, an Indian company. This is happening in India. On the 15th of September 2020, that is during the year, he's made this sale, which he acquired on the 4th of April 2016. Almost about 4 years back, he had acquired it at rupees 100 per share. And STD was paid both at the time of acquisition as well as the time of transfer of the shares. Basically, this one, if it's short term, it will be under 111A. And if it's long term, it will be under 112A, because there STD has been paid on both cases. You know, on 31st 1, 2018, something happened whereby Arun Jaitley gave a speech that long term capital gain will now be taxable. And because of that, they offered us a new tax, a new cost of acquisition, which is basically the highest price, or we will see the calculation, but they offered us a new cost of acquisition. We'll see it when we calculate capital gain. So there is capital gain in India. Yes, there is capital gain in India. Let's see anything else in India, abroad. That's it. That's it, guys. Now, based on the above facts, choose the most appropriate answer to question numbers 1, 2, 5. All right, let's start seeing the most appropriate answers. What should be the residential status of Animesh for the year 2021? That is financial year 2021, of course, assessment year 21-22. This is a question on residential status. So for that, I'm going to ask myself basic condition one. Has his stay in India been greater than or equal to 182 days? And his answer will be no. And if his answer is no, we go to basic condition two. But when we're going to basic condition two, you stop and you ask yourself, basic condition two is not applicable to two people. Indian citizens who leave India for employment or joining a ship, he is not one of those, because he's not left during the year for employment or joining a ship. Or persons of Indian origin or Indian citizen visiting India, he's one of those. He's an Indian citizen visiting India. So basic condition two generally does not apply. So he is becoming a non-resident. But wait, guys. Finance Act 2020 had made two amendments. They said that if you are an Indian origin or person of Indian origin or Indian citizen who is rich, that means who has Indian income greater than, or who is rich, that means who has Indian income greater than 15,00,000 rupees, then in that case, the second basic condition might become applicable. But 60 days, there is a condition, 60 days or more, will be replaced by 120 days, and 365 days will continue. So now we have to find out, to find his residential status, we have to find out whether he has Indian income of more than 15,00,000. Now he's just telling you the Indian incomes are already given here. There are four incomes: house property, interest, and capital gain. Interest is about 3,10,000. You don't have to calculate the entire exact amount, just more than that, more than 15,00,000. If you know, you've got an answer. So interest is about 3,10,000. There is some house property income also, and capital gain, which is the big one, where you have sold it for 480. Your cost may be around 300. So you're selling something for 480 where your cost is 300. So you made a profit of 180 into 10,000, which is 18 lakh is the income here. So straight off, your income is more than 15 lakh. It should be your Indian income, and your Indian income is more than 15 lakh. So congratulations, he is subject to that amendment, whereby basic condition 2 will become applicable to him, but with a small difference. He has to stay in India for greater than 120 days. Yes, he has stayed in India. If you see in this paragraph, he has stayed in India for 124 days. So that first part is proven. And the second part is more than 365 days. So 365 days. So even that is proven. So yes, second basic condition 2 now is fulfilled. And that makes him only a resident and not ordinary resident. Remember, the amendment did not want you to become a resident. The amendment is only for making you a resident, but not ordinary resident. And that is your first answer. That is your first answer. This in the exam will get you at least 2 marks, sometimes even 3, but this will MCQ based, it will get you at least 2 marks. Perfect. That's the first question. This is how you have to answer MCQ based questions, guys. Moving ahead. What would be the amount of total income taxable under income from house property in the hands of Animesh? Guys, you don't have to show it here. How you will present, how you will get the answer. You have to just get the answer, income from house property. Going back up and looking at income from house property. I'm going to do the calculations on the left-hand side. Here, guys, there are 2 income from house property. Canada one, you will not take. Why? Because for a resident and not ordinary resident, only incomes which are dear income, that's one of my shortcuts for all my CA inter students. That a non-resident and a resident but not ordinary resident is taxable only on dear income. What is dear income? Received in India, earned in India, accruing in India, and only deemed to accrue or rise in India. So hence Canada income is not one of those. So hence Canada house will not be included. But the flat in Delhi will be included, yes. So the rent, the actual rent, municipal value is not given. So in the absence of municipal value, fair rent, you only take actual rent. 30 to 500 into 12 will give you 3,90,000. Less municipal taxes. Guys, municipal taxes only if paid. They're saying that it is 40,000 and is paid by Animesh if he comes to India during the year. Has he come to India? Yes. So has he paid it? Yes. So 40,000 will be minus. Congratulations. So that gives you 3,50,000. And the proper word for this is NAV. From this, you always minus 30%. So into 30% is 1,05,000. This is section 24A. The shortcut is ad hoc, A for ad hoc, because it's a standard ad hoc 30% reduction. And 24B, B for borrowing. When you borrow, you pay interest. These are all small, small shortcuts that my students already know. I hope you're understanding these shortcuts. B is for borrowing. 24B is interest on borrowings, which is basically there is no capping on it because it's a let out property. So interest is 3,14,000. So I'm minusing 3,14,000. And that gives you 3,50,000. Minus 1,05,000, minus 3,14,000. That gives you a loss actually of 69,000. So there is no income right now. There's a loss from house property. But remember, there is one more. In respect of a house in Ranchi, he received arrears of 2,96,000. Guys, any arrears under section 225AA is for arrears, 2,96,000 will be taxed. But of course, you will get a 30% reduction. So 2,96,000 into 30%. Is 88,800 minus 2,96,000 will give you 2,07,200. So one income, one loss, both under house property. Can they be set off? Of course, you can set it off. So 2,07,200 minus 69,000 will give you 1,38,200. Congratulations. That's your first answer. Let's see which of the option is 1,38,200. Here it is, question number 2. Answer is B, 138,200. This is income from house property. Next, what amount of capital gain would arise in the hands of Animesh on transfer of shares of A Limited? They're looking at capital gains. We will go to capital gains of Animesh. Capital gain is only in India. Guys, capital gain is an interesting chapter. A lot of people find it difficult, but all I want to tell you is that I have a very, very nice shortcut to solve any capital gain chapter sum that is asked to you. Any capital gain chapter. Let me tell you what is the shortcut. The shortcut is ATSCP. Five words, five letters, ATSCP. Just find out what these five words are and you will get your capital gain answer. A is there an asset which is being transferred? Is there a transfer? What is the sale price? And when you compare the sale price, if it's land and building, etc., then you have to check it against the stamp duty value. What is the cost price? And what is the period of holding so that we know it's long term or short term? And if you answer these five questions, you would have got your answer of capital gain. So with this, let's see. Is there an asset which is being transferred? Yes, there are shares. So yes, asset. Is there a transfer? Yes, it is being sold. So it's a transfer. What is the selling price? The selling price is 480 and 10,000. So I'm just writing sale consideration. Selling price is 10,000 into 480, which is nothing but 48 lakhs. What is the cost of acquisition? So sale price also, we know what is the cost. The original cost is 100 rupees. That is when the long-term capital gain was exempt. That time you bought it for 100 rupees, but then Arun Jaitley came up in a speech and he said that this will become taxable. So hence they offered you a new cost of acquisition. If you remember the section, great, you can quote it. It's section 55(2)(AC). How do I remember this? Because I have given a shortcut to my students that it's a really cool section. 55 is the cost section and 2 second, there is a new cost, and AC, that means a very cool second cost. Of course, the cost will be higher of two amounts. Otherwise, why will it be beneficial? So it is going to be higher of the original cost, that is 100. Or these two, the lower of, what is these two? The FMV, that is the highest value, on 31/1/2018, that is 300. Or the sale price, that is 480. Amongst them, whichever is lower. So 300 here, 100 here, and the higher of the two. So 300 is your new cost of acquisition. So 10,000 into 300, which is 30 lakh, is your cost of acquisition. That is your cost. Period of holding. As for listed shares, for any listed security, it is 1 year. If you remember, more than 12 months, more than 24 months, and more than 36 months are needed to make an asset long-term. And that too, I have a shortcut for that. You will watch my fast track course or my regular course, and you will get to know, understand the shortcut. Guys, anything, you can always and always reach out to me or anyone at Unacademy to understand the schedule of lectures. But the fast track course has all the shortcuts incorporated already. This one is period of holding is more than 4 years, honestly, and therefore it's definitely long-term, because for listed shares, you only need to hold it for more than 12 months for it to become long-term. But long-term means indexation, but they don't give you indexation. Long-term means any other benefit, but no other benefit given to you, because the reason is this long-term capital gain of 18 lakhs is taxable under a special provision of section 112A. But they've not asked us the tax, they only asked us what is the gain. This, my friends, is the gain. What is the amount of capital gain that would arise in the hands of Mr. Animesh? 18 lakh is the answer. That is the third question. Excellent. Now that you know all the three incomes, the next question is a very, very easy, nice question. What is the total income of Animesh if he does not opt to pay tax under 115 BAC? Guys, 115 BAC is another option that is given to individuals and HUFs. If you ever feel 115 BAC is difficult, I have simplified it for you. On YouTube, I have put a lecture on 115 BAC. Also, in my shortcut course, I have discussed 115 BAC at great length. Watch out and you will understand how easy 115 BAC is. I've given you great shortcuts to help you understand and by heart 115 BAC. All my lectures, guys, have one similar strategy. Everything happens in class. You understand the concepts in class. You by heart it with me in the class. Everything happens in class, so you don't have to do anything outside of it. Guys, here is the total income of Animesh other than 115 BAC. So we have to ignore 115 BAC. Now, total income basically means, is there any income from house property? First, is there salaries? No, there was no salary. Income from house property, we just calculated here, is 138,200. So I'm just going to write 138,200. There is no PGBP in India. So there is no PGBP. Is there any capital gain? Yes, there is 18 lakhs worth of capital gain. That is long-term capital gain. Is there any IFOS? Guys, there was some interest income. Half of it, it was 6,20,000 if you recollect. And half of it was received in India. So 3,10,000 because received in India, it will become taxable in India. So this one is 3,10,000. So 1,38,200 plus 18,00,000 plus 3,10,000 gives you 2,248,200. But this one is not, this is your gross total income, guys. 2,248,200. And see how well they have given you the wrong answer as well. This is a wrong answer because they've not asked you gross total income, they've asked you total income. And you know, there was an 80C reduction because he, Mr. Animesh, has taken a loan on which he's paid principal to a bank. Here it is, Canara Bank of India, and he's paid 80,000 as principal. So even that has to be minused. Even that has to be minus. So 80,000 I'm minusing there. And that's how I get to my answer. The right answer, 2,168,200. To confuse you, they've also given you gross total income, but the right answer is this, 2,168,200. That, my friends, is the fourth question. So we're done with four MCQ questions. That will be about 8 marks in the exam, slow and steady, but getting there. For MCQ, you don't have to show any working. For MCQ, life is really, really simple. No workings have to be shown by you. All right. Moving ahead to the next question. Now that you figured the total income, they want you to calculate the tax liability so as to minimize his tax liability of Animesh for the year AY 21-22. Let's do this, guys. His total income, which we just got right, is 2,168,200. This is all the heads minus the deductions. If you got this income, 2,168,200. Now, typically someone would just think that, oh, he's 60 years and more. So he has basic exemption limit of 3,00,000. So let's calculate his tax, but stop yourself, guys. Whenever you have total income, always ask yourself, is this total income? Does it have any incomes which are taxable at a flat rate? Yes. There is a long-term capital gain out of this, which is worth 18,00,000 rupees, which is subject to a different rate, a special rate under 112A. So I'm keeping that separate. And when you minus 18,00,000 from 2,168,200, you get 3,68,200. This is your other income. Now this one, you can do, you can subject it to basic exemption limit, etc. So out of 3,68,200, 3,00,000 is your basic exemption limit. But why am I not minusing basic exemption limit from long-term capital gain? Because section 112A says that this will first be exhausted from other income, and only if any basic exemption limit remains, only then it will be eating into long-term capital gain. So I'm minusing it, the basic exemption limit I'm minusing. Why 3,00,000? Because he's 61 years old. So 68,200 into 5%, because that's a slab. So 68,200 into 5%. Will give you 3,410. I'm just writing 3,410. Perfect. This is the first part. Now for long-term capital gain of 18,00,000. Under section 112A, if you remember 112A, the first 1,00,000 is exempt, is not taxable. So on 17,00,000 at 10% will give you 1,70,000. So this is under section 112A. Where the tax is only at a rate of 10%. So this is your total tax. 1,73,410. Guys, always remember, your tax liability is not just your basic tax, but also includes in surcharge and cess. Surcharge is only applicable if the total income, yes guys, surcharge is not connected to any other income, but total income, if it's more than 50,00,000 or more than 1 crore or more than 5 crore or more than 2 crore, more than 5 crore, only then there is surcharge. Here, the income is just 21,68,000, and hence there is no surcharge. So only cess, only higher health and education cess of 4%. So when we add 4%, you get to a final number of 1,83,347 or 346. But you know, there are two rounding offs. One, I did not round off because it is already rounded off, the total income. And one is total tax, not basic tax. Total tax has to be rounded off. So 1,80,350. 1,80,350. This, guys, is the answer. This is the fifth question. Congratulations. One by one, you're getting better and better and better. So that's your tax liability. Animesh's case is almost coming to an end. Now there's another Mr. T, but again, the same concept. Read the question and then answer. Let's read. Mr. T, who's an Indian citizen and a resident of India, earned dividend income of 4,500 from an Indian company. Guys, as you know, from the date 1st of April 2020, that is the first day of your financial year, dividend income is now taxable. Very simple. Whoever earns it in his hands, dividend income is taxable. So dividend income is now taxable. Mr. T earns dividend of 4,500. So it's taxable under which head? Dividend only has one direction. That's what my shortcut says. Under IFOS, it is always taxable under IFOS, 4,500. But when dividend is declared, there's a section called section 194, which says that TDS will be applicable at the rate of 10%. Of course, during the year 2021, because of COVID, there was a 25% reduction in this rate from the 14th May 2020 to 31st March 2021. So I'm reducing that. So that becomes 7.5%. But section 194 also says that this 10% or 7.5% will only be applicable if it's above 5,000 rupees, the dividend, if it's given in check or through bank account, etc. But this threshold limit is not there if it is given in cash. So let's see whether it is given in cash. Generally, guys, dividend comes in your bank account directly. But here they have said paid in cash. So if it's paid in cash, then the 5,000 limit is not there. So any amount paid will be subject to a 7.5% tax. So 7.5%, this one is 7.5%. So the answer is such dividend is taxable in the hands of Mr. T, and Indian companies required to deduct tax at source at 7.5%. Such dividend is taxable in the hands of Mr. T and Indian companies required to deduct tax at source at 10%. No, 10% is not there because there's a COVID discount. Don't call it the COVID discount. I'm just referring it to that. Such dividend is taxable in the hands of Mr. T. However, Indian company is not required to deduct TDS. This could have been the right answer had it been that this was not paid in cash, but this is not the right answer. Such dividend is exempt. Sorry, exemption was before 1st of April 2020. Now it is taxable, and hence A is the right answer. All right, let's go to the seventh question. Each question is so good. It's so good and it's so important. Let's go to the seventh question. Guys, before we look at the seventh question, I must just tell you that return of income, section 139.1, says that there are three dates of filing the return due dates. There are three due dates. The first one is 31st July. The next one is 31st October. For people who are subject to audit, they get 31st October because you need some more time if you're subject to audit. And for people who are under transfer pricing, 30th November. So there are basically three dates. The light in my, I'm actually not at home. I'm somewhere out. Hence, the light is slightly an issue. I hope that's okay. As long as you can see the screen and as long as you can hear me, I think it should be good too. So there are three dates, but for CA Enter, it's more July and October, which are important, 31st July and 31st October. Now, in 31st July and 31st October, let me tell you, how does it work? If you're audited, example, a partnership firm, if they're subject to audit, when will they be subject to audit? If their turnover, if it's a professional partnership firm, then turnover more than 50 lakh. And if it's a businessman, our turnover more than 1 crore or 5 crore as the case may be, then they're subject to audit. If they're subject to audit, then the partnership firms, if a partnership firm is subject to audit, then the salary and the interest they pay will be decided. The salary and interest which they pay to partners will be finalized only once their audit is finalized. And hence, even the partners who get salary and interest, even their return of income will have a due date of 31st October. But what if the partners are not auditable? Even then, because as you know, a partnership firm, whatever they pay, they are getting a deduction, and the same amount the partners are taxed as income, and hence the same amount. And for that, they have to have the same due dates as well. With that, and this is a recent change, that both working partners and non-working partners both have the extended due date if the partnership firm is auditable. But if the partnership firm is not auditable, then both will have the same due dates, that is 31st July. Now let's see this question. Mr. X is a working partner and Mr. Y is a non-working partner of a partnership firm. The partnership firm is subject to a tax audit under section 44AB. Shortcut is 44, audit the books. AB, audit the books. Guys, there are so many shortcuts that I teach. In fact, 90% of all my sections are taught through shortcuts like this, so that you never forget it, easy to recollect, especially one day before the exam, and easy to reproduce in the exam as well. What is the due date of filing the return of income for X, Y for the year 21-22? Guys, the partnership will have the due date of 31st October. So even the partners will have it for 31st October. 31st July for both? No. 31st October for both? Yes. 31st July for X and 31st October for Y? Sorry. 31st July for Y. And this used to be the right answer. This used to be the right answer, but they made an amendment that now both working as well as non-working partner will have 31st October. So this, my friends, is the right answer. That's your seventh question. We're just three questions away from ending the MCQs and then going to the other questions. If we can't finish this, I'll do another live. And in that other live, we will continue here and we will also go to IDT questions. Let's move ahead to the next one, Mr. Arpit. Mr. Arpit is an employee of MNO Limited and has contributed 1,61,280 towards NPS. Guys, before I move ahead, National Pension Scheme is a great new scheme established by the government. Why and where did they establish it? They established it, they all sat at CCD, Cafe Coffee Day, and they established it. Why? Because these are shortcuts to remember Section 80 CCD. It's a pension scheme, and hence if you contribute to this pension scheme, you get a deduction under 80 CCD 1. You get a deduction under 80 CCD 1, but 80 CCD 1 is under the capping of 80 CCC, that capping of 1.5 lakhs. Plus, you get a deduction under 80 CCD 1B, which is not under any capping of 50,000 more. And this is your contribution, but if your employer contributes, that means whoever you're working with, even that employer contributes, even then you get a reduction, but that is maximum. So this is subject to maximum of 10% of salary. So NPS, there are three deductions. 80 CCD 1 is your contribution, maximum 1,50,000. But along with other 80 C series, it's 1,50,000. 80 CCD 1B is also your contribution. It's another benefit that you get, another 50,000 rupees reduction. And 80 CCD 2 is your employer's contribution, maximum 10% of your salary. Salary includes your salary plus your basically your BDC, basic salary, plus DNS allowance, which form part of retirement benefits, plus commission, which is a percentage of turnover. Now, he has contributed 1,61,280. So ideally, under this section, you should get 1,61,280. I'm just putting the numbers. His employer has also contributed similar amount. So even employer 1,61,000. Guys, this does not mean I've already taken the reduction. There are certain limits. We'll have to see the limits. But right now, I'm just parking those numbers under the section. His basic salary is 80,000 per month. So to calculate this limit, I'm just calculating this limit. You have to calculate his salary. His salary is 80,000 into 12. And plus 40% is his DNS allowance, which forms part of retirement benefits. He also paid 55,000 towards LIC premium. I'm writing it here, 80C, because that is also within the limit of 1,50,000. You have to put 80C also, 55,000 LIC premium for himself and his wife. As LIC premium can be paid for yourself also, for your spouse also, and children also. 80C has a small family, you, your spouse, and your children. And medical insurance premium of 35,000 by cross-check for his mother being a senior citizen. So that is not in the limit. So I'm keeping it separate. This is ATD. Can he get 35,000? Yes, he can. Why? It's supposed to be 25,000 for parents, but the parent is a senior citizen, hence 35,000 is perfectly okay. How much deduction is available under Chapter 6A is what they're looking out. Basically, they want to ask us deductions. Very interesting. First, there is a capping of 1,50,000 under 80 for ATC, ATCCC and ATCCD part 1. There's a capping of 1,50,000. Now let's say, how will you use this 1,50,000? You use this 1,50,000 for ATC first, so 55,000, and the remaining 95,000 you use for ATCCD 1. So out of 1,61,250, 95,000 is gone and 55,000 is from ATC. So the first deduction is under ATC plus ATCCD 1, and that is 1,50,000. The limit is over. Yes, the limit is over. But you have contributed 1,61,280. Out of that, only 95,000 has been taken a deduction. So is there anything remaining? 1,61,280 minus 95,000. So it's 66,280 is remaining. So can I put it here? Yes, you can put it here in the other benefit, but this is restricted to maximum 50,000. So this one, you will get maximum 50,000. I'm putting that also. ATCCD 1B is 50,000. Those are two deductions already. So this one done and this one done. Now let's go to your employer's contribution. Your employer is also contributing 161,280. That is great, but it can be maximum 10% of salary. So 80,000 into 12 is 9,60,000. 40% of this is 3,84,000. So, and there's no commission, which is a percentage of turnover. So these two total up to 13,44,000. This is your salary for the purpose of ATCCD. And this salary of 1344 into 10%, guys, maximum 10% is allowed. So 1,34,400. Maximum this much is allowed. So 1,34,400 is allowed under ATCCD2. 1,34,400 is allowed. Perfect. So one more done. Yes, one more done. So that brings us to the last one, that is ATD, in which 35,000 will be allowed. So these are the four deductions. Let's total them up. 35,000 plus 134,400 plus 50,000 plus 1,50,000. That gives you 3,69,400. Let's check the answers, guys. A is 346. Yes, guys, the second one is the right answer. 3,46,400. Very, very important and interesting concept. I'm just going to summarize it one last time. ATCCD 1 is basically under the umbrella of 1,50,000. So if you contribute a lot, please take some amount and put it under ATCCD 1B, where the maximum is 50,000. And in case your employer contributes, that also you will get a deduction. That is because they want to encourage people and employers to contribute to NPS. So you get a deduction, but that is maximum 10% of your salary. So if you contribute more than that, like in our example, so you'll get maximum 10% of it as a deduction. That is ATCCD2, 1,34,400. Perfect, perfect. That brings us to the ninth question, a very interesting question, and also a shortcut which you already know. A building was acquired many years back for 20 lakh and is sold during this year for 80 lakh rupees. The stamp duty value as on the date of transfer was 85. Although the stamp authorities are saying it's worth 85, you are selling it only for 80 lakh. Maybe you're taking cash, maybe we'll check. The fair market value of the building as on 1/4/2001 was 25 lakhs. Its stamp duty value as on the same date was 22 lakhs. Guys, this is another recent change. So hence, this becomes very important. Determine the capital gain. The moment there is capital gain, there is only one shortcut, ATSCP. For more such shortcuts, watch out my fast track program. For more such shortcuts, watch out my entire full comprehensive course, which is starting in October. So you'll watch out for all these shortcuts and more in my lectures. Is there an asset which is being sold? Yes, a building. Is there a transfer? Yes, it was sold. What is the selling price? The selling price is 80 lakhs. But when you sell, sometimes you have to check it. So section 50CC is for checking it. They will check it against the stamp duty value. Stamp duty value was 85 lakhs. We'll see. We'll check it. Your cost, actual cost or original cost was 20 lakh rupees. But on 1/4/2001, your fair market value was 25 lakhs and your stamp duty value was 22 lakhs. Your period of holding is long term because for a land and building, you need to hold it for more than 24 months. This is much, much, much more than 24 months. So this is long term. So whatever ultimately the gain will happen, they've not asked us, but I'm just telling you, the tax rate will be 20% and you will also get indexation. So let's start calculating this. Section 48 says that how do you compute capital gains? First, you take the sale consideration, which is 80 lakhs. But when you take it, just check it. There's a section called section 50C. 50C says that take your sale consideration and multiply it or give it an extension of 10%. So basically multiply it by 110%. So that is 80 lakh into 110%. That is 88 lakhs. And now see your stamp duty value, which is 85 lakhs. Is it within that range? Yes, your stamp duty value is within 88 lakhs. And hence, we have no problem. A little bit here and there is probably okay. But if the stamp duty value was, let's say, 95 lakh, then they would have taken 95 lakh as a sale consideration because they know you've taken some cash. So here, this one is section 50C. Now, cost of acquisition. Hey, generally, cost of acquisition is the original cost or the fair market value as in 1/4/2001. That is up to you. Generally, you would take the higher one. So I would generally take 25 lakhs. But in the Finance Act 2020, they've said that this FMV cannot be more than the stamp duty value. You can still take the FMV, but just ensure that it's not more than stamp duty value, which is here is more than stamp duty value. So limit it to stamp duty value. So your cost of acquisition is going to be only 22 lakhs. Of course, indexed, so divide by 100 into 301. So 22 lakh divide by 100 into 301. 22 lakh, sorry, my math. 22 lakh divide by 100 into 301 will give you 66 lakh 22 thousand. If there are any expenses on transfer, you can minus that. Of course, those are not indexed. If there's any cost of improvement, you can minus that indexed also. So this one, guys, is 80 lakh minus 66.20 will give you a profit of 13,78,000. This is a long-term capital gain. This is 13,78,000. Answer is A, 13,78,000. Perfect, perfect, perfect. Just 1 second and we continue ahead. All right, so that brings us to the 10th question now. A 10th question again is an MCQ. Is this one? It's really interesting. It's on IFOS, it's on gift taxation. Let's see how this works. Mr. Vikas received a gold ring worth 60,000 rupees on the occasion of his daughter's wedding from his best friend, Mr. Vishnu. Would such gifts be taxable in the hands of Vikas and Kavya? So I'm only first looking at Vikas. This is Vikas. If you know IFOS gift taxation, great. Otherwise, I have a three-step process. In these three steps, you get your answer. The first step is whenever you get a gift for gift taxation, there is a three-step process. The first step is check if it's property. And for that, there's a shortcut, MISB SATJO. Is it MISB SATJO? That means, is it money, immovable property, securities, bullion, sculptures, archaeological collection, drawings, jewelry, artwork, and work of art? Yes, this is jewelry. So this is step one. If step one is fulfilled, then you go to step two. Example, if this was a bike, then it is not MISB step, so it is not in gift taxation. Step two says that is it one of those occasions like marriage, like inheritance, And that also I have a shortcut, don't tax tip and money received from LA HUF, but I'm not telling you the shortcut entirely right now because we don't have the time to go into such detail. But all I'm trying to tell you is that if it's in your marriage, you get a gift, it's not taxable, but it is not one of the situations. So you go to step three, and step three has three categories: money, movable property, immovable property. This one is a gold ring, so it's movable property. So whatever movable properties you've got in the year, total it up. If it's totaling more than 50,000, then the entire amount, not the excess, the entire amount will be taxable. So first step, MISB Sajjo, is it ring? MISB Sajjo, yes. Is it step two? No. Step three, is it movable property? Yes. Is it more than 50,000? Yes. So Mr. Vikas, you will be taxed on 60,000 under IFO. And same thing for Kavya. Kavya also has got a gold chain worth 80,000 on the said marriage, on her marriage. So step one, is it MISB Sajjo? Yes. To step two, is it one of those ring, etc.? Yes. But step two is it is received on her marriage. So in this case, in Kavya's case, it will not be subject to gift tax. So value of gold ring is taxable, yes, but value of gold chain is not taxable in the hands of Kavya. This one is the right answer. Congratulations. All 10 MCQs done and dusted. We will look at the 11th question, also the 12th question, but 11th question has a small mistake. I'm just going to correct the mistake here. So I'm just going to tell you what the mistake is. This is, sorry, not here. The small mistake in the 11th question. I'll just correct the mistake and then we will do the sum. The mistake is not you by made by you or me. It is made by ICI. This is a small mistake. Unit X is 35 lakhs total sales. Export sales is 27. And domestic sales is 8. And this is 6. So this is 18. Perfect. So this was a mistake. There was a small mistake here, 27 and 18. Perfect. Yes, the mistake is here. This has to be 22. All right. All right, let's look at this sum, guys. Messrs. Rajveer, a proprietorship has two units, namely X and Y. Unit X is located in a special economic zone. Guys, special economic zone, I don't call it special economic zone. I call it awesome area. Because why? Because the moment you're in special economic zone, that is the awesome area, you get a benefit of 10 AA, 10 awesome area. So let's continue. 10 awesome area. So unit X is in the awesome area and they will get benefits. You know, the benefits are like this. For the first 5 years, you get 100% deduction of export profits, not overall profits, only export profits. The next 5 years, you get 50% of export profits. And the last 5 years, again, you get 50% of export profits, subject to a contribution to a special reinvestment reserve fund. The following are the details of financial year 2021. Guys, these are details and we have to focus on unit X, which is the SAZ unit. Let's move ahead. Let's see what they are asking. The total sales include freight of 5 lakhs for delivery of goods outside India with respect to unit X. I'll tell you what to do with this. But what are they asking us is both the units were set up in 2017-18. So 17-18, that means, guys, 2021 is in the first 5 years. That means you get 100% deduction. Compute the amount of deduction available to Messrs. Rajveer under section 10AA. First up, the deduction in the year 2021 is 100% of export profits from the SEZ. So 100% of profits. How do you calculate export profits? What is the export percentage? The export percentage is 27 divided by 35. Why am I not looking at unit Y? Why am I not looking at the entire one? Why? Because I have to only focus on the SEZ unit. So export sales is 27, total sales is 35. So 27 lakhs divided by 35 lakhs. This is the export percentage. E. And what is the profit? The profit, I think, is 6 lakhs. Yes, the profit is 6 lakhs. Now, there's a small change, a small thing that you need to do. Now, this is great. This answer will get, you'll get in this calculation the answer. But a small clarification here, that while exporting, there are three things you can do. When you export any goods or any services, guys, there is freight. That means delivery. There is insurance and there is telecommunication charges. Guys, freight, insurance and telecom. Example, exporting goods, will you not have to ship it? Yes. Will you not have to pay insurance? Yes. Will you not have any other courier, any other telecommunication charges like STD, ISD phone calls or faxes, etc.? All these three have to be excluded while calculating the export turnover as well as the total turnover. So this 5 lakhs I have to minus from 27 also and from 35 also. So 100% of 22 lakhs divided by 30 lakhs. So I've reduced 5 from both ends into 6 lakhs. And let's see what is that. 22 divided by 30 into 6 lakh will give you 4,40,000. Will give you 4,40,000. Guys, this is the deduction. Congratulations. This is the deduction under section 10AA. That is your question. What is the deduction available to Mr. Rajveer under section 10AA? And this is the deduction available to Rajveer under section 10AA. We have one more question. But while we look at that question, I just want to see how much we've done on the RTP. Just one second. Perfect. All right. So while we move ahead and we look at other questions, honestly, the next question will take a lot of time. And there are about four questions remaining in the RTP DT section. I'm just showing you that. The 12th section, 12th question. Then there is a 13th question, a 14th question, and a 15th question. So that will take us some more time. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to discuss with you the strategy of one day before the exam, just one day before the exam strategy before we enter into the second life. Guys, this is an RTP. This is something that you have to do after you finish your portion. If you're looking at completing your portion for December 21, I have a great fast track course, which I've already completed, and you should check it out. It'll be really helpful for your exam preparations. And if you're a May 22 student, then definitely you should look out for the full comprehensive course that is starting in October. And that'll be really, really helpful to get you great marks, exemptions, and even a rank at CA Inter level. And now for exam strategy. One day before the exam, you have to start studying and complete IDT first. It's smaller, it will give you a lot of confidence. And even in the exam, you will have to do the MCQs of IDT first before you move on to the practical and theoretical questions of IDT. So complete IDT and wrap it up. Then you move on to DT and then you complete the same pattern, MCQs first and DT questions later. Remember, guys, the CA inter exam, so it's not going to be the easiest exam. But even if 10 marks are difficult, and even if 10 marks you don't get to know, don't feel the nervousness, because remember, out of 90 marks, you can always get great marks. But of course, your aim should be to cover the entire syllabus and to not leave anything. Making small notes, doing a tax marathon on an academy, are sure short ways of getting great marks, because you'll help and revise faster. Whatever you do, make sure that your revision one day before the exam is apt, and make it so concise that you can revise everything in one day. I will ensure through my tax marathon that I do that with you guys here, right here in An Academy, a live tax marathon that takes us through everything, including some exam questions. For all that and more, watch out. I'm going to be back soon for the second live where we discuss the remaining RTP November 21 and also the IDT questions. Thank you so much. My name is Saurabh Mutha. Watch out. Let's see again. Let's meet again for the fast track course, and also let's meet for May 22. Thank you so much.